Good afternoon, everyone. This is Tube H7 again. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath, I hope you're still having a peaceful and blessed Sabbath. Now, this video is still in reference to another question I was asked about feeling forsaken. So I'm going to speak about that for a few minutes because that being forsaken or feeling forsaken is something we can easily mislead ourselves in believing that we are or aren't being. And we play an important role in whether we are being forsaken or not by the Heavenly Father. So with that being said, turn with me to 2 Chronicles 15 and verse 2. I'm going to read this second part of verse 2. In the latter part it says, "The Lord is with you while ye be with him. And if ye seek him, he will be found of you. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you." So it's very simple and clear about being or not being forsaken. If we seek the Father, we can find him. We'll be found by him. But if we forsake him, he will forsake us. So, you know, already don't be misled in believing that at any time you want to call on the Father that you're going to find him. Because you can spend a whole lot of time forsaking the Father when he's trying to call on you. And then when a crisis that you deem a crisis hit, you want to call on him. And then you feel like, he's forsaking me. He's not here with me. You have to be in tune with the Father all the time. He's not a part-time Heavenly Father for you. He has to be in your life. You have to be willing to have him in your life at all times. So that when you do call on him, he will let you know he's always there. And understand this. If you're living your life according to the word, don't ever feel forsaken. We have to go through things to understand how to go through things. We have to experience things to understand how the Father works, how we're carried through our trials and tribulations. So for the sake of just forsaking us, the Father is not going to do that unless we choose to allow that to happen. We allow that to happen by first forsaking him. So always remember, he chooses secondly to forsake us because we have chosen first to forsake him. Now, let's go to 2 Corinthians 4, and we're going to read verses 8 and 9. And they read, it says, "We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed." Now, also understand that we're going to go through things. We're going to be persecuted. We're going to be cast down. We're going to be treated all sorts of any kind of way. But we have to understand that if we love the Lord and we're doing his will, he is going to be there with us. We don't go through this by ourselves. He goes through this with us. Let's go to Romans 8:17. Romans 8:17 reads, it says, "And if children," well, let me go up to 16 first. It says, "The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are children of Yahweh." 17, it says, "And if children, they're heirs, heirs of Yahweh, and joint heirs with Yahshua. If so, be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together." So understand, when we're being persecuted and when we're going through things and you have this thought or idea that you're being forsaken because you're going through something and you're living it and feeling it and going through the misery and sorrow of it, understand that he's going through it with us. In fact, once you get through it, don't ever believe you got through it. He was with you and carried you through it. So always keep that in mind, that we're not forsaken as long as we're doing his will, as long as we're doing the things that we're supposed to do that he asks of us. He is always with us. We just have to understand that. We have to trust in that and have faith in that. And we have to let it happen and go through what we go through. Because everything that we do is not right. We suffer the consequences of that. So, you know, we're always reminded that we're not infallible. And all these little things that we do that are not right, that are against His will, that are against the character that we're supposed to be portraying, we have to atone for that. So, you know, we can ask for forgiveness and we can be forgiven, but we still have to suffer the consequences. We never come out of this clean and unscathed. Okay, go with me to Psalms 125 in verse 3. Now, it reads, it says, "For the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous, lest the righteous put forth their hands into iniquity." You're not going to be forsaken if you're doing what's right, but you're going to go through stuff, remember. Remember, it says right here, it says, "The rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous." Even though you may go through something and you feel like you are not going to survive it, the rod of that wicked will not rest upon you. And then second part, it says, lest the righteous put forth his hand into iniquity. Now, understand this. It is very simple and clear. If you put your hand out there into that wickedness, well, okay, the rod of that wickedness can fall upon you because you subjected yourself to it. Remember, the Father is not going to stop us from committing sin. We have free will. We can do whatever we want. But when we step out there in the midst of doing something unrighteous, we can just as easily fall under the persecution of that wickedness. So if you go jump in front of a moving bus, best believe you can get hit by that moving bus. The Father is not going to pull you back. You put your hand into that iniquity. You purposely did that. Don't tempt the Father. He is beyond temptation. He will not be tempted of you or me or anyone else. And with that being said, let's go to our last scripture, 2 Peter 2, verse 9. 2 Peter 2 and verse 9, it reads, it says, "The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust until the day of judgment to be punished." Now, listen, it says, "He knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation." Remember, I was just talking about that bus. If you accidentally stumble off a curve and you're being right and you're a righteous person, you're doing what's right, you accidentally stumble off a curve, the hand of that angel may pull you back in the nick of time. See, there's a difference. You didn't tempt the Father. That was accidental. See, so we have to recognize the differences. We don't tempt the Father and expect to survive it. It can cost us our lives. We have to be in His will and doing things according to His will. So, remember, He also knows how to reserve the wicked, which He's doing. He's reserving all these wicked, whether they're alive when He comes or whether they have already been dead and buried. He's reserving them until the final judgment. So don't get caught up and believe that you can live your life any way you want, do anything you want, because if you die in a wicked state, you're just being reserved for the final death. So live your life according to His will. Stand on that foundation once again and do what's right. And with that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be obedient to His word, to His law, to all the things He will have us do, His will. This is 2B87. I'm out.